Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
Welcome to Faith Lutheran Mission Church. My name is Nick Kessler, pastor here at the church. Good morning to everyone who is sitting in our pews, and good morning to everyone who is watching us online. Number of announcements for today, Christmas! Hey, it's that time of year. Yep, Operation Christmas Child. We're going to bang that off this week. Got the table set up downstairs with lots of boxes ready for you to use to put your goodies in for the kids overseas for their Operation Christmas Child boxes. Also, if you don't want to use those, then go out and purchase a plastic box. That's even better because I can always save the cardboard boxes for next year as well. Right now, I'm going to put up a short video to tell you about how the effect that Operation Christmas Child has all over the world.
These children around the world, God bless you, and keep packing those boxes.
Yeah, significant impact. We continuously do this every year at Faith Lutheran Mission Church. We're going to continue that this year as well. And the impact is not only getting gifts to kids who will probably never, ever get any other gift in their lifetimes, and it's going all over the world, but more importantly is the evangelism effect. They're hearing the word of Christ, and these kids are being discipled. Not only do they get the word of God in the boxes themselves, but that's all followed up with a teaching and a discipleship afterwards by Samaritan's Purse. Big impact. All you got to do is pack a box. So grab one downstairs, buy one, fill it up. Let's set another record. 38. Can we do it again this year? That'd be awesome. All right, now we're ready to worship. Caleb's going to bring us into the presence of the Lord with some music. I just ask you to open up your hearts and minds for what God has to say for you today.
Thank you.
Our opening hymn for today is I Was There to Hear Your Morning Cry. We're going to be working out of the blue hymnal today. This is hymn number 770. Words will also be up on the screen. I ask you to please rise as you are able. Will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of Lutheran congregations in Mission for Christ and by God's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our next hymn is Jesu, Jesu, fill us with your love. Still working on the blue hymnal, hymn number 765.
Preserve what your right hand has planted.
They burn it with fire like rubbish. At the rebuke of your countenance, let them perish.
Let your hand be upon the man of your right hand, and Son of Man, you have made so strong for yourself.
And so we will never turn away from you. Give us life that we may call upon your name.
Restore us, O Lord God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
The second reading is from Philippians in chapter 2, starting verse 4. Don't look out only for your own interest, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges, he took the humble position of a slave, and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Dear friends, you always followed my instruction when I was with you, and now that I'm away, it is even more important. Work hard to show the results of your salvation. Obey God with deep reverence and fear, for God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. Do everything without complaining and arguing, so that no one can criticize you. Live clean, innocent lives as children of God, shining like bright lights in a world full of crooked and perverse people. Here ends the reading. Please stand for the gospel.
Pressing out the grape juice, and built a lookout tower. Then he leased the vineyard to tenant farmers and moved to another country. At the time of the grape harvest, he sent his servants to collect his share of the crop. But the farmers grabbed his servants, beat one, killed one, and stoned another. So the landowner sent a larger group of his servants to collect for him, but the results were the same. Finally, the owner sent his son, thinking, surely they will respect my son. But when the tenant farmers saw his son coming, they said to one another, here comes the heir to this estate. Come on, let's kill him and get the estate for ourselves. So they grabbed him, dragged him out of the vineyard, and murdered him. When the owner of the vineyard returns, Jesus asked, what do you think he will do to these farmers? The religious leaders replied, he will put the wicked men to a horrible death and lease the vineyard to others who will give him his share of the crop after each harvest. Then Jesus asked them, didn't you ever read this in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see. I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation that will produce the proper fruit. Anyone who stumbles over that stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone it falls on. When the leading priests and Pharisees heard this parable, they realized he was telling the story against them. They were the wicked farmers. They wanted to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowds who considered Jesus to be a prophet. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Please be seated. In our gospel text for today, Jesus tells this very interesting story about a landowner and some farmers to whom he rented his land. In Jesus' story, the landowner does all the work in the beginning. The land is his, and he plants a vineyard. He digs a wine press where the grapes can be trampled and the juice extracted. He builds a wall and a watchtower so the crop will be protected and guarded. Everything is in order and already prepared for a great crop of grapes. The twist in this story is that the landowner then leases the vineyard out to a group of tenant farmers and goes away. And the tenants completely understand that someday he will return. However, the landowner gives them a great deal of freedom and will not be there to watch over their every move. The farmers are simply to tend to the crop and the land. Then, when it is time to give the landowner his share of the harvest, it's a simple plan and everyone wins. The landowner gets what belongs to him, the tenants are provided for, and they get what they have earned. However, a problem arises when there is a rebellion among the farmers against the landowner. There's no mention at all that the landowner has treated them unfairly or has wronged them in any way. The problem is that the tenants get greedy. They no longer want to be the tenants of the vineyard. They want to own it. They want it all. All the crop and all the land as well. So when the landowner sends his servants to collect his rightful share of the fruit, the tenants mistreat and beat the servants, even killing some of them. And this happens several times until the landowner finally sends his son, expecting that they will respect him and give the landowner what is his due. However, the farmers conspire even against the son. They say to each other in verse 38, "Here comes the heir to this estate. Come on, let's kill him and get the estate for ourselves." Then they took him outside the vineyard and killed him. Let's take a deeper look at this parable from Jesus. What Jesus is actually doing here is telling the world's story and predicting his own death to the rebellion of God's creation. God is the landowner. He has made the world and everything in it. He planted all the trees and plants that give us food. He gives the world to us and makes us his tenants. We are renters, not owners. However, we are provided for very well, just like the tenants in the parable. The landowner then moves away to another country and is out of sight. Just like today, where many people think God seems to be way out of sight and not present. However, the reality is that God is still the owner, even though it seems like he may not be visibly present. Just as the landowner of the vineyard is not physically present, he also still owns the land and everything in it. We've been given a good world and a great deal of freedom. The land is fruitful. We are blessed to have been given the privilege of being tenants here. And God has been good to us. However, a problem has arisen. A rebellion is being gathered among the tenants. There are many people who want to claim the master's land and everything in it as their own. And they want the true master of the land to stay out of it. They even abuse those who come and remind them that this world is not their own. And they refuse to recognize God's ownership of the world. just like the landowner in the parable, God has been forgotten and people have gotten used to the idea that all of this is theirs. Plus, all too many of the tenants of this world today do not want to give God what rightfully belongs to him. So when God sent the prophets to call the people of the world to recognize God's ownership and give him what he is due, those rebellious tenants of the world not only became hostile to God, but even killed his messengers. This has happened throughout the history of the world, and still happening now. In many places of the world today, to preach the good news of Jesus openly is to face the possibility of imprisonment or even a death sentence. That is, if you even have the chance to preach the good news. And it's happening here in this country as well. Well, people are not actually being killed to preach the gospel. However, any voices proclaiming that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life is quite effectively being snuffed in America by the media and even other churches. Which seems to be the story of our Jesus rejecting world. It's how the world is treating the landowner. And the interesting thing in Jesus' parable is that it's the religious folk who reject Jesus. Let's take a look at verse 45 from our gospel text. When the leading priests and the Pharisees heard this parable, they realized he was telling the story against them. They were the wicked farmers. Even in the realm of religion, Jesus is not wrong. He's too radical, and his person and power are overwhelming. The world today prefers a God that they can understand, control, and even manipulate. The world, and even many Christians, are still resisting and fighting God himself. They don't want the Ten Commandments, or any commandments. Especially since they begin with the words from Exodus chapter 3, verse 20, "You must not have any other God but me." People today will worship anything. The sun, the moon, and the stars, trees, rocks, water, crystals, pyramids, and even money and power. Anything but the true landowner. One of the interesting things about this parable is that the landowner does not demand everything. He only asks his share. He treated the tenants fairly, really more than fairly. However, the tenants did not want fairly. They wanted it all. God, as the landowner, has been rejected and his son has been killed. They have been thrown out of their vineyard and their world. And yet, Jesus quotes the scripture from Psalm 118, verses 22 through 23, by saying this: "The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see." So Jesus gives us the real end to the story. It does not end in defeat, but victory. The very stone, this one who has been rejected and killed outside the city, will return and become the foundation of a new kingdom. And the true final end of the story is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 15. Listen to these words: "Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices shouting in heaven, 'The world has now become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever.'" The The Pharisees even tell Jesus in verse 41 from our gospel text today that they thought the landowner who refused to recognize the leadership, what's going to happen to him? They say, he will put the wicked men to a horrible death and lease the vineyards to others who will give him his share in the crop after each harvest. The Pharisees thought the landowner would kill the tenants just as they had killed his son. However, God, the real landowner, would do the exact opposite. He would use the death of his son as an atoning sacrifice so that he might forgive the rebels and ultimately give them a land that was beyond anything they had ever known. Friends, not only do we need to realize and understand and accept that our Jehovah God is the true rightful owner of the vineyard we live in, we also need to realize, understand, and accept that there will be a reckoning for the responsibility that God has given us. And yet, we have a loving God whose plan for the final reckoning is based on this truth from John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we are amazed at the words of your son told over 2,000 years ago, which still completely apply to our world today. Lord God, we are sorry when we forget that you truly are the landowner of this world and we are just tenants. Help us, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, to remind us that everything we have, including ourselves, are yours. And we pray this in the holy name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Our next hymn is Lord, You Give the Great Commission. We're still working out of the blue hymnal. This is hymn number 756. Words will also be up on the screen.
Preach the word.
As they have stood by for us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we pray for those people putting their lives on the line in our own communities. Law enforcement, ambulance, fire department personnel, emergency room personnel, and hospital. Lord, protect them while they are on shift. Keep them safe. Lord, we have sirens out there on all these response vehicles to remind people to watch out. But also, Lord, those sirens are a reminder to us to pray. To pray for that situation. Even if we're nowhere near that situation, Lord, every time we hear a siren, let it be a reminder to us, Lord, to pray for the situation and pray for those responding officers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for those people who are proclaiming your gospel truth far away from family and friends, Lord. All missionaries that we support individually and as a congregation, Lord, protect them. Keep them safe. Protect them from any kind of human evil. And Lord, please protect them from the darts of Satan. And Lord, please protect also all of their ministries from any kind of human evil and evil of Satan. And Lord, we really, really pray that you can provide all of those missionaries that we support with the resources they need to do those ministries you have called them to. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
If there's anyone who has any prayers that they would like to make at this time, please go ahead and say them.
Heavenly Father, please bring your healing touch to our family friend, Jeff Smith, who suffered an aortic aneurysm a little over a week ago. He's been struggling for his life, fighting for his life, been through many, many surgeries already, and has a long way to go to fully recover. We need prayers. He needs prayers.
Yes.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all those people who are in need of your healing touch. There's so many people who maybe just went through a cold, but some who are also dealing with COVID and cancer. Lord, we ask you to bring your healing touch down to all of those people who are on our minds and hearts. We pray for continuously. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the mercy of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share the peace of God with one another. I thank you in advance for your grateful and gracious hearts. Anyone who is watching us online that would like to provide for their ministries here at Faith Lutheran Mission Church, address is at the bottom of the screen. If you can write out a check and send it to us, we promise to use it for building the kingdom of God. Also, PayPal is available.
Thanksgiving, what you have first given us, ourselves, receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. If I could have you please rise as you are able, we are going to sing with a joyous noise the words that our Lord has taught us. To sing today, O Christ the Same. We are still working out of the blue hymnal yet. This is hymn number 778. Words will also be up on the screen. Thank you. to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.